Hello everyone, welcome to our show Creative World. I'm your host Shin Matsuba. We'll be introducing some amazing talented people, chatting with them in a one-on-one interview, hearing their stories, picking their brains, looking through the kaleidoscope of Creative World. Today's Creative World is music. Today's guest is one of the most famous music composers and producer who is very active in the US, but also plays a significant role in the Japanese entertainment industry. Since he joined the music industry, he has been working for a lot of famous singers, including Christina Aguilera and Beyonce. He has also produced or composed over 1,000 songs for numerous Japanese singers and movies and TV commercials. I'm so excited to talk to him today. Please welcome Joey Carbon.
Hi, Shin. How are you?
I'm pretty good. Thank you for joining us today. So to begin with, you worked for the famous TV show Star Search for 9 years, right? And then could you tell us if you faced any difficulties or hardships while working on that show and how you overcame them?
Star Search. Yeah, that brings back great memories. Star Search was a talent show. It was the predecessor of American Idol and all the shows like that. It was very successful. It was on for about 11 years. I was the music director and theme composer for the first about 9 years. And one of my responsibilities was to find talent. And it wasn't always very easy to find really good talent. So that was one of the challenges. I got lucky though. I went to Las Vegas once and I went to one of the casinos and I saw some people performing. And one of them was a singer named Joseph Williams. Joseph Williams later became the lead singer of the super rock, multi-award, Grammy award-winning group, Toto. Joseph knocked me out when I heard him sing. So I brought him to the show and Joseph was able to make it all the way to the finals of the first season of Star Search. Obviously, after that, he did very, 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 very well being the singer of Toto. He was also in the adult voice of the singing voice of the Lion King in the movie The Lion King. And he's a very, very talented guy. I have since produced most of his solo albums and we became really good friends. So that was a challenge, which turned out to be great. Another one was about the theme song. The producers of the show had wanted an original theme. So they put the word out to a lot of famous composers, music composers, and they asked me to try to write one as well. Well, when I saw some of the competition that I was up against, I wasn't so sure that I could do it effectively. For example, there was Bill Conti, who won Academy Award, super, super movie producer, music producer for many, many hit movies, including Rocky, and he won the Academy Award for The Right Stuff. Also, Paul Williams, who wrote a lot of the hits for the group The Carpenters, submitted a theme, and I heard them, and they were really great. And I thought, well, all I can do is try my best. And so I did. I went in and I tried my best. I thought about the show and you know, what I thought would work. And I made recorded a demo, and fortunately, they were able to choose my song. I was very, very surprised, but my song became the Star Search theme for the whole run of the show.
I see. So I heard that you began your career as a singer, right? So what made you later decide to become a composer and producer?
Well, when I was around 15 years old, my childhood friend, and he's still my closest friend, his name is Richie Zito. I went to Richie's house one day and he was playing guitar. And I thought, wow, that's really cool. So I just started singing with him, you know, Beatles songs or whatever. And we made a little band. And I went out and bought a bass guitar and I learned how to play bass guitar. And I became the singer and the bass player in this neighborhood, Brooklyn, New York band. We started becoming popular in our area. One day we were in Manhattan, New York City, and we saw the Rascals, the group The Rascals, who had a big hit called Groovin', walk into a recording studio. And we followed them in because we were big fans of The Rascals. We were doing their songs when we played live. And we were met by a British recording engineer named Chris Houston. And really, really nice guy. And Chris said, well, what are you guys doing? And we said, well, we have a band. And he said, why don't you come and audition for me and my partner, Bob Gallo. Bob Gallo was a producer. He had worked with James Brown and a lot of other people. And he owned the studio. And we went in and auditioned. And they really liked us. So they started making demos with us. And eventually, he brought Jerry Wexler, one of the co-owners of Atlantic Records, over to the studio for us to audition for. And Jerry liked us. He signed us to Atlantic Records. We released a few singles, and nothing really happened with the singles, but I got a part-time job in the mailroom, my summer vacation at Atlantic Records. And when I had free time, I would go to the recording studio in the same building and watch some of the major recording artists of Atlantic record. Groups like Eric Clapton's group Cream, or the Rascals, or the Soul Queen, Aretha Franklin. And watching these recording studio musicians working, and watching the famous engineers, Tom Dowd, the famous music arrangers, Arif Mardin, and famous producers, Jerry Wexler, Bob Gallo, working with these artists, I started being influenced. And I thought, that's something that I want to do, because it was totally creative. And I was very influenced by that. Actually, Richie and I started writing songs very, very early. During that era, we started writing some of the songs that we released. Of course, in, you know, kind of baby form, but that's how we got our start. So then I came to Los Angeles and I started playing keyboard. My instrument became keyboards. I would go on tour with a lot of people like Rick James and Air Supply and the Righteous Brothers. And I worked with Elton John once. And I later became known as a studio musician and a touring musician, and eventually started arranging songs and then producing artists myself. The first artist that I produced with Richie Zito was an artist named John O'Banion. We had a big hit in the United States called Love You Like I Never Loved Before.
So as a producer and composer, you have worked for many celebrities such as Christina Aguilera and Beyonce, Justin Timberlake, since when they were just diamonds in the rough. So what do you think those successful artists have in common?
Well, yes, when I worked with them on the TV show Star Search, I had arranged and produced their backing tracks, their music for them, that they appeared on the show and performed to. And they were very young. We had a children's category on the show. We had an adult category for singers. They were in the children's category. So they were very young, but you could still see that they had some special spark to them. Of course, they had vocal ability and talent, really, really good singers, great singers, but they had stage presence. And they were really good looking too at that young age. They were cute or attractive. So those things are all important, but you can kind of see the potential. I mean, at least I could. I think these kids are gonna go very, very far, and they did. Then I've had the chance to work with a lot of artists like Little Richard, who was one of the originators of rock and roll music. I produced an album for Little Richard a few years ago, and I remember thinking, boy, so many people call themselves legends, but this guy really is a legend. I remember the first time he sang, we re-recorded a version of Good Golly Miss Molly, one of his hits, and I was in the control room as the producer, and when he started singing, my mouth just dropped open, and for that moment, I wasn't the producer of the project anymore. I was just a fan and a great admirer. This guy who truly was the king of rock and roll. So I think for anybody to be successful, not only do they have to have a certain look and of course talent, but they have to have some kind of special spark which makes them unique from other people.
As a lot of people know, your work has had a big impact on the Japanese entertainment industry. Tell us about that, please.
Well, I went to Japan first with a singer named John O'Banion that Richie Zito and I were producing. And we also were members of his backing band for a concert tour of five Japanese cities. And at that time, we also, in addition to doing the tour, we performed at the Tokyo Music Festival, which was a yearly international 2 or 3 hour TV special in Japan, and with international artists competing. And we won the grand prize with one of my songs called I Don't Want to Lose Your Love. We won the grand prize, and also Richie and I won Best Arranger Awards as well. That song later was recorded by American country singer Crystal Gayle, and it went to number one on the country charts in America. So I had started writing shortly after that for Japanese artists. Since then, I've composed or produced over 1,000 songs that have been released in Japan. About 100 songs for the Teen Idol Factory, Johnny's Entertainment. And probably I would say my songs have been on albums or singles, maybe 120 or 130 of them that have become either gold or platinum certificate projects. There was an article that I did for the Japan Times, and the title of the article was From the Streets of New York to the King of J-Pop. Well, I certainly don't, I'm certainly from the streets of New York, but there's no way that I would even dare to say that I'm the king of J-pop. I've been very lucky to have quite a few hits there and a lot of success due to my love of Japanese music and Japanese people, and also with the support of my many, many Japanese friends and clients over the years.
And what do you think is necessary to succeed internationally?
Oh boy, well, I mean, what does it take to be successful anywhere, really? You have to have talent, of course. You have to have, you know, you should be attractive, you know, in some way. If not physically handsome or beautiful, have some kind of really cool look, right? You should establish your image the way that Madonna established her image years ago, the way that Lady Gaga, her name is Stephanie Germano, but on stage she's Lady Gaga. The same thing with Madonna. She was Madonna Ciccone, but on stage she became Madonna, right? So those people established their image and their look and their personality that made them special and unique from other people. Also, I mean, to be successful internationally, you really need to have the support of your record company and management for them to be willing to make a commitment for you to succeed in other territories.
So now, with everything going on in this world right now, what kind of activities are you currently working on?
I've been in Japan over 100 times. 2019, I went there 4 times. I've been there as many as 6 times in 1 year. Last year, 2020, was the first year that I was not able to go to Japan at least 1 time in a year. And I miss it a lot. I miss it very much. But in the meantime, I've been still writing, composing songs, my home studio, and doing some of it with collaborations with my former students at GK Gakuen. I'm a vice principal at GK Gakuen in Japan, which is a college group. We have music colleges in 8 different cities. And when I'm able to go to Japan, I go to the different cities and give lectures for the students on music business and songwriting. And if I find a talented student, I try to connect with them and do collaborations. And I've been very lucky to have given them and me, with our collaborative efforts, some hits in Japan with some major artists. Aya Matsuura, King and Prince, Stones, Bishonen, a lot of the boys' idol groups. And but because I can't go to Japan, I'm not able to do these lectures. So last month I did about 16 Zoom lectures for schools in 8 different cities on various subjects. One subject was, what's the difference between J-pop and Western music? Another one was critiquing the students, songwriting students' original songs, and trying to make how to make the song better, how to make the demo better, and then what to do with the song after that. Another one was the birth of an original song, where I show them how I created an original song from the phone call I got from the Japanese producer, who, by the way, was a good friend of mine, Johnny Kitagawa, who is the owner of Johnny's Jimusho, or Johnny's management company. He's the king, he was the king of J-pop boys idol groups for many, many years, and I composed about 100 songs for various artists. So in that particular lecture, I would talk about the phone call I got from Johnny requesting a song, and then all the different steps, and then finally culminating with showing them video of the group King and Prince singing the song on TV. But still composing and still doing lectures via Zoom. But I can't wait till I can get back over to Japan live again.
Wait, there's part 2. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our channel.